incredible, isn't it? It has a magnetic attraction. Each time I return to this city, it looks entirely different to me. There is no other place on this earth that attracts as much love, passion, and longing as Jerusalem. And more than anywhere else, this mountain, Mount Moriah. Here was the offering of Isaac. Here the first temple was built and destroyed. From here the Jews were exiled to Babylon. Here the second temple was built and destroyed. Thousands of believers and conquerors wept, fought, and prayed among these stones. Now, they have fallen silent. But once this spot looked very different. 3 times a year, Jews from all over came on pilgrimage here to God's house. On Sukkot, Pesach, and Shavuot, a very important commandment. Back then, it was no easy trip. The journey along the winding road to Jerusalem was long. People spent weeks trekking here. Can you imagine this pilgrim walking to Jerusalem, a tent strapped to his back, arriving from a village in Galilee or Judea, a village with only 10 or 15 houses and a few dozen people. He stops before a massive structure, the largest structure ever built in the country. He's never seen so many people, thousands of people, dressed in white, sacrifice in hand. Above them, the temple. Even the smallest stones in the wall weigh 2.5 tons. Try to imagine this man standing beneath Robinson's Arch, the stone structure named for its discoverer, looking up at the Temple Mount. I've always wondered what that felt like, passing the walls, touching the stones, holding his breath. This broken cup, does anyone know what it is? I don't have an answer. So many relics lie scattered here, but for some reason this cup attracted my attention, and I can't stop thinking about it. Whose was it? Or how was it used? Here the pilgrim ended his long journey from Judea or the Galilee, or from across the Jordan, or from Greece. His physical journey had come to an end, but his spiritual journey was only beginning. Hidden inside his robe is his bundle of coins, his wages of an entire year, or maybe more. A half shekel coin.
That'll be 300 per dog. You're 4 short.
And what if he doesn't have enough money? Perhaps he bought something with him to sell for such a situation. Perhaps it was the cup. Was it a measuring cup, or maybe not a cup, but a precious container? Now he's gotten his half shekel and must buy an animal for sacrifice with a few coins remaining. He couldn't carry his sacrifice all the way from his village to Jerusalem without it getting hurt. The sacrifice rules were clear, but not always easy to follow. A woman who had given birth brought 2 doves. A cured leper brought a sheep. Our pilgrim, like those before him, bought the sacrificial animal here. I'd like the goat.
Okay, it'll cost you 400 per dog.
$400 perhaps a little fainter. We brought her some water. The journey continues. His body trembles as the moment approaches. Now he goes to one of the ritual baths. The degree of his purity depends upon him and his intentions alone. He enters the closed building. The stone steps are divided in two. He descends on one side, still in an impure state. He immerses his naked body, with nothing coming between him and the water. After he dips, he ascends on the other side of the staircase, purified. For this important moment of his life, he won't leave behind a trace of impurity. Now purified, careful not to touch any impure object or person, he ascends the staircase to the Holda Gate and emerges on the Temple Mount, prepared and sanctified. I can almost hear his heart pounding wildly and feel his excitement. Stunned, he finds it difficult to move as the temple looms before him. The glittering building before him is the Holy Temple. In awe, he proceeds onto the temple platform. Can you see it through his eyes? Behind him, the tall columns of the royal portico. A huge plaza filled with tens of thousands of people, purified, approaching the temple. The breathtaking building of colossal white stones, towering high above the courtyards. Opposite him, smoke rises from the sacrificial altar. Up to the barrier surrounding the temple, entrance is permitted to all. Only Jews may pass beyond it. Women can go as far as the women's court. Beyond a certain point, only the Levites and the priests may pass. Only priests are allowed into the closed building, and only the high priest may enter the Holy of Holies on Yom Kippur. The pilgrim probably never read the writings of ancient Greek and Roman authors about Israel. They speak of three wonders: the Dead Sea, in which all objects float, a single day of the week during which no work is done, and above all, the temple, which does not contain a single statue. The temple is not a gathering place, but the house of God. Thus, worshippers assemble around the temple while the sacrifices are performed only by the priests. He presents the sacrifice to the priest. The priest raises his hands. The smoke ascends from the altar. I can almost smell it. And in the midst of all this, the pilgrim from a small village in the Galilee stands in awe. This was once a bustling place. We'll never know all the true details. We can only imagine how the temple looked, what the people looked like. What did they hear? What did they feel at this holy moment? We'll never really solve the mystery of the cup either. Still, I keep coming here to walk among the past and listen to its echoes. Sometimes I can even see him, see our pilgrim, finally turning to head home, but carrying a memory that will last a lifetime.